What's cracking,
big dogs?
Welcome back to the channel. Welcome back to the headquarters. My name is Nicholas. This is BDGE. Big dogs gotta eat. We're talking running backs today. We're talking early, top of the food chain, elitist running back rankings. It doesn't get more important than running backs in fantasy football. It doesn't get more important than the first round of running backs in fantasy football. You hit on these guys, you got a league winner. You're straight to the championship. You miss, we'll see you next year. We're looking at a fucking animal-esque season. So today we're gonna be breaking down, depending on how long I go for. I like to chop these up because I like to get in depth on most of the running backs. Because we can't fuck these up. We don't got leverage like that, okay? You need to hit on your first round running back. So we're going to go through possibly the top 10, maybe the top 6. We'll go with the flow and see where we end up. So today, top 6 fantasy football 2021 early running back rankings. Tuck our shirts in. Stop yelling and let's eat. If y'all enjoy the video at any point, make sure you hit the button that looks like this right down there. It's not the one that looks like this. It's the one right next to it. It looks like this. Subscribe to the channel. If you're new, we're doing fantasy football stuff, both dynasty, season long, redraft, best ball, all that shit, all off season long. Number one, and I can't even believe this is a debate, but Christian McCaffrey of the Carolina Panthers. I get it. He got hurt last year. He's not injury prone. He's not bad now. In fact, he was the best that he's ever been in the limited sample size that we have from last season. Obviously finishes as he's the RB53 because he plays three games. Where does he finish in terms of points per game in those three games? Number one, Alvin Kamara, Dalvin Cook, David Montgomery, and Derrick Henry. What do these four running backs have in common? They are the only running backs who finish with more 24.8 or more PPR point performances than Christian McCaffrey this year. Again, Christian McCaffrey played in just three games in 2020. You look back at Christian McCaffrey's 2019, that was his league winning season. If you had him on your team, you won the chip. If you didn't win the chip, you're an absolute beta. In that season, he averaged 25.7 fantasy points per game. This year, he averaged 27.2. All right, quit the bullshit. We not with it. If for some reason, you know, he is involved in that Deshaun Watson trade to the Texans or whatever, we'll figure that out. We'll do a whole nother video on it. But for now, we expect him to be Carolina Panther, Christian McCaffrey, bike in action, premier, elite 2019 Christian McCaffrey, 2021, fire him up, running back one, tier one, elite, that's it. Number two, it's the big girl out of Tennessee, man, is Derrick Henry. King Henry sat upon his throne, running back number two overall, number three in points per game. 2,027 yards on the ground, 17 touchdowns. This dude is matching the year with his rushing yardage total. We're living in 2021. He's rushing in 2027. Another year underwhelming through the air, 19 receptions, 114 receiving yards, but who gives a shit? The offense is going to be good again. Ryan Tannehill's playing lights out. If there's anything that's going to have an impact on this offense, it's going to be the departure of their offensive coordinator, Arthur Smith, to the Atlanta Falcons. Let's fucking go. I'm a fan of that dude, man. They ran play action at the highest rate of any team in the NFL. 36.5% play action rate, which is partly why Ryan Tannehill was so good and the offense was insanely efficient. Even with 17 touchdowns Derrick Henry had last year, that could have been way more. Ryan Tannehill threw 12 touchdown passes inside the 5-yard line last year. 12 touchdown passes inside the 5-yard line. He also rushed for 2 touchdowns inside the 5-yard line. It seemed like every time they were on the goal line, they play action, they hit the god Anthony Firkser out there. Tight ends were racking up points in the red zone. So that number could have easily went from 17 up to 22, up to 23, up to 24 for Derrick Henry. That could be what we're looking at next year. Derrick Henry is about as safe as it comes. The passing upside is not there, but like it doesn't fucking matter. He's going to get 350 carries and he's going to break off 60, 70, 80 yard runs every third game and win you that week. Clear as day, running back number two, Derrick Henry. Other thing clear as day, my vision. Because, and that is thanks in part to these glasses from Felix Gray. Okay, I stare at computer screens all day. I got a monster monitor right here. I've got my laptop down there. I've got a screen on top of my camera, and I've got a cell phone right here. I'm inside of a screen 24/7. When I first started running BDG, the brand, I was working like 14 hours a day doing this stuff. And by the end of the day, my eyes were like bleeding out of my face hole. My mom was like, "Are you? I've seen you all day. You've been working at the kitchen table, but I feel like you're doing drugs in front of me because your eyes look like you just snorted coke." I said, "No, mother, these screens will be the death of me." I had headaches before I went to sleep. I could barely sleep because my eyes are so fucking strained. And then I discovered Felix Gray and that all went away. I literally cannot, I cannot endorse this brand and these glasses more for people that work on their laptop and look at their screens all day. They are blue light blocking glasses for those y'all. The blue light is emitted from these screens and they fuck up your head. They mess with your head and they mess with your eyes and they cause headaches and they are a problem when you're trying to sleep. You know how every time you look up like, I can't sleep, I've got insomnia or whatever, and the first thing on the list every time is like, stop looking at screens before you go to bed. Boom, this combats that problem. Wear these during the night. Wear these when you start shutting the lights off. And guess what? The blue light coming from the screens will not mess with you anymore. If you are someone who gets eye strain, who gets headaches from looking at screens all day, who works in an office environment where you're looking at screens for 8, 10, 12 hours per day, this will literally be the best investment you will ever make. I've been wearing these for like 3, 4, 5 years. That's when I found Felix Gray, and they just found me. So they are the sponsor of today's video. But it could not be more of a natural fit because I love these. They actually also sent me these. I don't know if these fit my face so much, but they got a ton of, I'll be looking like a true fucking hipster straight out of Brooklyn with these bad boys on. They do not fit my face. We're going to rock the rest of the video with these on anyways to make you feel wildly uncomfortable. They have a ton of different styles on the website. These are, I believe, called the Hopper. These are also on the website. They got a ton of different styles. And the best part about these is like you can wear them. You know, they look good too. They look good too. Girls be looking at me like, oh, he actually looks smart. I know he's probably dumb as hell, but he looks smart. That's the thing. Most of the blue light glasses that you purchase online have these big orange frames. That's why I love Felix Gray, because you could wear them in normal situations when you're out, when you're at a coffee store, and not look like a crazy person. There's no orange tint, so you look smart, you're working smarter, and you're healthier. Your eyes will thank you, I promise you that. I'm gonna link the Felix Gray website down below. I'm gonna link it in the description. I'm gonna link it in the comment section. Go check out the wide variety of glasses they have. They also are available if you have prescription glasses, so you can get that combo. It's like the Christian McCaffrey of glasses. Not only are you getting the receiving and the rushing work, not only are you getting the prescription, but you're getting the blue light as well. You're getting the best of both worlds. I cannot recommend these enough. I love y'all. And if you love me, you'll go check out Felix Gray. Link down below. Best purchase I've made in the last 5 years. As the kids are saying, no cap. Running back number 3. Jonathan Taylor of the Indianapolis Colts. He finishes as the running back 6 overall, number 10 in points per game after a miserably slow start where we started giving up on him. We said he's the next Trent Richardson. As a rookie though, man, a lot of ups and downs, a lot of ebbs and flows. Taylor finished number 3 in the NFL in rushing yards, 1,169. Albeit this was not a great rushing yardage season statistically, so I don't know how impressive that is. Kind of like saying like Snacks is the third best looking dude at the bar when the lights come on. Like when you throw in that little parameter at the end, it hits different because all the good looking guys already left. That's like the rushing yardage totals just aren't really there for running backs anymore because there's so much passing work going around. Nonetheless, he's a rookie, slow start, still finished 3rd in the NFL in terms of rushing yards. Finished with 232 carries, 1169 on the ground, 5 yards per carry, 11 touchdowns. In the receiving game, he was quite efficient. The volume might not have been there. 41 targets, 36 catches. He caught 36 of 41 targets, 299 yards, and a tug. He did this while playing on 47% of the Colts snaps. 47% of the Colts snaps. I really feel like I'm like running for office. Jonathan Taylor went on 47% of the snaps, and thus he should be your... Plays on 47% of the snaps, which means other people taking snaps. Who was it? It was Jordan Wilkins, it was Nyheim Hines. Both of them are going to be back for 2021. But once week 11 hit, it was like, you know, it took a while for them to gain trust in Taylor. He got a little banged up and then moved back down the depth chart and then moved back up the depth chart. What we saw from week 11 to week 17 and into the playoffs is what we should be expecting next year for the Colts in this backfield and Jonathan Taylor, where Jordan Wilkins became just a distant memory. Wilkins dropped off the face of the earth. He played on just 10% of the snaps from weeks 11 to 17, which is, you know, an 8-7-8 guy, can't do math, game sample size there. So Wilkins was a non-factor. And this was a big year for all of these rookie running backs when you look at the playing time and how it was dispersed, right? When you look at Taylor, Dobbins, Swift, Akers, all took a while for them to get into their real role in this offense, for their offensive coaches to starting to trust them and then to play more efficiently on the ground. It was a theme this year, so I'm not worried about how slow all these guys started as long as they finish strong and what we can project going into the next season. So going back to like that week 11 spot, week 11 hits, and from that point forward, Jonathan Taylor averages 22.3 touches per game, including that playoff game. He scores 9 touchdowns in those final 7 games. That's why Taylor is such a dangerous player for fantasy next year and just going forward in general, because he's got that size, that 225 pound frame, which means he's going to get almost all of the goal line work. But he also has the speed, the breakaway, that home run playability where he can break off for a 50 yard touchdown on any given carry. He's a wildly explosive runner. He's ripping off more chunk plays than Uber Eats is ripping off customers. Delivery fee, service fees, customer fees, fake news, tax fees, food fees, fee fees. Jonathan Taylor is the Uber Eats of fantasy football, the way he's ripping shit off. Look at breakaway runs, plays of 15 plus yards, number 2 in the NFL. Breakaway run rate, 6%. So 6% of his carries went for 15 plus yards. Extremely high number in the NFL. 3rd in the NFL in runs of 40 plus yards. tied for first in the NFL with 40-plus yard touchdown runs. Again, he's a home run threat on any given down. He's going to be a double-digit touchdown player for the remainder of his rookie contract and going forward. And one of the reasons we love, or the main reason that we love the landing spot in Indianapolis, was that offensive line. You pair him up with Quentin Nelson and the rest of the guys up front, them thick boys. Run blocking efficiency, number 4 in the NFL per player profiler. They were number 3 per PFF in run blocking grades. If there's one red flag for Jonathan Taylor here, it's obviously the quarterback position, okay? Phillip Rivers is retired, and Phillip Rivers is notoriously known as one of the best and most voluminous screen game quarterbacks of all time. So what happens to JT in the receiving game, right? That's not what really bolstered his numbers. He had 41 targets, 299 yards, and a touchdown. So it was a nice little boost because he was so efficient in that aspect of the game. But that's not why you draft Jonathan Taylor. When we look back at last year, the Colts passed the ball to the running backs at a rate of 25%. Only the Chargers, the Patriots, and the Saints passed to running backs at a higher rate. The NFL average was 17%. 17%, and they pass it to the running backs at a rate of 25%. And we know that work. Even that number one is going to come down probably to the 22, 21% range. That's still being split between Taylor and Nyheim Hines. So he's gonna have some problems in the receiving game. As per the quarterback, I don't know what's going to happen. It looks like they're going to push strongly to sign someone in free agency. They offered something to the Eagles for Carson Wentz. I believe it was 2 second-round picks, which they denied. I think if they get desperate, like worst case scenario, I could see them ending up with Carson Wentz. Best case scenario is they sign someone else that's not Carson Wentz. And I think they're going to do it through free agency. This is not a team that is built to rebuild. They're not a team that's going to be looking to draft a rookie quarterback and then develop it for a couple of years. They're ready to win now. They're going to grab a quarterback. So overall, I'm not overly concerned about Jonathan Taylor in the receiver. There's nothing on this outlook that I'm overly concerned about when it comes to Jonathan Taylor. He's in the same tier as Derrick Henry and the guy that we'll talk about next at number 4, as long as they're not starting like Jacob Eason at quarterback next year. Let's move to number 4. That's Dalvin Cook, running back 3 overall and running back 3 in points per game. Played in 14 games this year. So now we have back-to-back seasons in which he's finished as the running back 3. Also back-to-back seasons in which he's played 14 games. 312 carries this year, 1,557 yards on the ground, 16 rushing touchdowns, 54 targets, 44 receptions, 361 receiving yards, and 1 receiving touchdown. Offense runs through him, obviously. He has that league-winning fantasy running back upside that very, very, very few guys actually have nowadays. Now, the reason that he's below the Derrick Henrys and the Jonathan Taylors is simply, you know, him being able to stay on the field. I feel a lot more confident in those guys and me getting the full 16 games in my first round fantasy running back or in my top 5 fantasy pick or whatever, right? He's number 4, so he'll probably be the number 4 player off the board for me in terms of my rankings. These will move, obviously, as the weeks and the months go by, depending on reports and different free agency movements and NFL draft movements and shit like that. But for right now, Dalvin Cook, whereas he seems to wear down and break down a little bit as the season goes by, these other guys, not only are they staying healthy, but they seem to be getting better. The Jonathan Taylors, the Derrick Henrys, those guys of that size and stature seem to be getting more fucking vicious as they enter those double-digit weeks. Dalvin Cook, good as any running back in the NFL. One of the best pure runners and one of the most explosive players in the NFL. The one change that we will see this year in Minnesota, that the Vikings hired Clint Kubiak as the offense coordinator, takes over for his father, Gary Kubiak, who retired last month. As per team reports, I mean, Clint is 33 years old, so they're just literally just handing it off to his son. That's whatever. The Vikings head coach, Mike Zimmer, reportedly wanted to keep the team's offense in place, so the younger Kubiak will allow Kirk Cousins and company to keep the same offensive language and concepts in 2021. Clint spent 2 seasons as the Vikings quarterbacks coach after 3 seasons as Denver's quarterbacks coach. So again, they've relayed that they want to keep the offense the same. I don't think much is going to change in terms of the offense that they've got going on here in Minnesota. Even if they go a little bit more pass heavy, Cook is a phenomenal pass catcher, and that will probably just mean a little bit of an uptick in his receiving game, which I am fine because even if volume drops a little bit, volume will go up in the passing game. And every time you get a target, it's much more valuable than just a simple carry on the ground. So Cook's in the same tier as Taylor, Henry. Whatever way you want to flip, flop, and move those guys around, I'm fine with that. Now, number 5... Alvin Kamara at the 108. Alvin Kamara had sort of a roller coaster season this year for fantasy owners who were rewarded with drafting him in the first round with the number 1 overall running back in fantasy. A lot of that had to do with the absolute scorching red hot start he had to the year over the first month of the season, as well as that 6 touchdown week 16 game. Number 1 overall running back in fantasy. Final stat line: 187 carries, 932 rushing yards, 16 rushing touchdowns, 107 targets, 83 catches, 756 receiving yards, 5 receiving touchdowns. So he sets career highs in rushing yards, rushing touchdowns, targets, receptions, receiving yards, and ties his career high for receiving touchdowns. Started absolutely red fucking hot out of the gate, as I said. He scored 7 touchdowns in his first 4 games, averaged almost 140 total yards from scrimmage, and 7.5 receptions per game. He was almost single-handedly leading your team to a 4-0 start out the gate. So things slowed down a little bit, but even on the non-touchdown scoring games, he was giving you a floor of like 18 PPR fantasy points per game, and then Drew Brees gets hurt. And this is why things get so interesting for Alvin Kamara. Because Brees gets hurt, Taysom Hill takes over as the starting quarterback for the next 4 games while Brees is sidelined. And the splits were cheek-clapping. On the left, you see the 4 games with Taysom Hill as the starter. On the right, you see the 11 games in which Taysom Hill was not the starter. Half PPR fantasy points per game with Hill, 12.95. Half PPR fantasy points per game without Hill, 25.91. Almost double, actually more than double, even in PPR, because the reception numbers went down from 6.6 to 2.5. He didn't have a single receiving touchdown with Hill under center. His targets dropped from 8.3 down to 4. His receiving yardage was abysmal. Saw about the same volume in terms of rushing attempts and rushing yards, but the receiving game is what took such a big hit, because Taysom Hill, instead of dumping off, he'd rather run with the ball. Where Kamara gets drafted this year and where I have him ranked is going to change wildly depending on what happens in the quarterback situation. Now, New Orleans is in cap space hell. They are like $90 million over the cap right now. Drew Brees, he retires. I believe he's going to wipe like $30 million off that cap space. But it begs the question, what happens next year? Because they got to make a lot of other moves, right? They're going to have to get rid of a lot of key pieces here, not just Drew Brees. They still have $60 million after Brees leaves. Taysom Hill is signed through 2021. $16 million would be the cap hit to have a starting quarterback, which is a phenomenal number in today's day and age where everybody, like backup quarterbacks, get $16 million a year. What happens with Jameis Winston? Jameis Winston played under a $1 million contract this year, which is unheard of for any sort of reputable quarterback. Jameis Winston, they've basically said all offseason, Sean Payton, New Orleans front office, they've been very, very vocal about wanting to bring Winston back and let him rip under center. Can they get a deal done is the question. And like more often than not in the NFL, teams make the money work somehow. But Winston, again, just played under a $1 million contract. So I'm going to guess he wants to get paid this year because he basically just played for free to sit and learn under Drew Brees and probably wants to be rewarded for it. And if there's any team that can't pay him for it, it is the New Orleans Saints. Unless Jameis Winston really believes in himself and he wants to sign another prove it deal, whether it's 1 year or maybe like a 2 year team friendly contract, that could be the case. Because he would, if he plays well and he does believe in himself and he's actually still somewhat good, he's going to put himself in a really, really good situation a year or 2 years from now to get a fat contract where he's still only like 27, 28 years old. And be the face of the franchise for the New Orleans Saints and under Sean Payton. A very enviable position to be in. So obviously as fantasy players, like we want Jameis Winston under center, right? Because he'll throw the ball, he'll pass the ball. He's not afraid to take chances down the field. His offense will be a lot more high tempo. There will be a lot more passing volume overall to go around. Also, he's not going to eat up 35% of the offensive plays by running the ball while under quarterback. No scrambling, especially not on the goal line, which is what Taysom Hill does. The other note here is that even if they bring Winston back, I really do think this is going to be like a quarterback by committee. I still think Taysom Hill is going to play a very, very big role, a bigger role than he did when Drew Brees was starting. So it's going to be a very weird, a very odd, a very interesting situation to kind of monitor and to see what happens throughout. But Alvin Kamara is going to swing a lot depending on what happens in that starting quarterback situation. He's as talented as any running back in the NFL right now, and he's still in the same perfect position. He's going to be here for a while. He got that contract extension. But if Taysom Hill is under center, it obviously hurts his upside and just the involvement in the receiving game overall. So he is number 5 right now. He can go all the way up to like 3-2, whatever, but he could probably drop back to around, you know, 7-8 in that range. Next up, number six, the final player on this list. I'm going to executive decision, dictator decision. We're going to cut off at 6, and then next week's we'll go 7 through 12, where shit starts getting real interesting because we got a lot of these rookie running backs. You know, you got the Cam Akers, you got the DeAndre Swifts, you got the J.K. Dobbins mixing in with some of the veterans. So things will get interesting as I do my research throughout the week. Make sure you're following me on Twitter because I'll be tweeting out some nuggets from the research that I do throughout the week. But number 6, should be no surprise here. Most people are going to probably rank him up at like running back 2 or whatever. Now, this RB6 ranking has absolutely nothing to do with me thinking that Saquon Barkley is injury prone. I don't think he's injury prone. However, we have actual science to back up the injury that he suffered last year and what that means for his timetable and what he'll probably be like in the year of 2021. So week 1 of last year, playing against Pittsburgh, he carries the ball 15 times for 6 yards. Week 2, they play against Chicago, and boom. Guy tears his ACL, his MCL, and his meniscus. He's leaving this sour taste in all of these fantasy owners' minds, right? You know, their mouths, their minds. Can you have a sour taste in your mind? I don't know how that works. But if it's possible, Saquon Barkley did it to y'all. Don't you ever, ever, ever forget that Saquon Barkley went for 2,000 yards from scrimmage and 15 touchdowns as a rookie. Don't you ever fucking forget that. But the injury, right? It's not just the normal ACL tear. It's the meniscus, it's the MCL, and it's the ACL. Tears it in week 2. And we know, if you've been following my channel at all, we are advocates of not drafting someone straight off the ACL tear. We like to draft them 2 years removed from the ACL tear, when they can get back to full 100% physicality as well as a mental standpoint, okay? So when Saquon Barkley tears his ACL, we know this from a scientific timetable standpoint, a 9 to 12 month recovery to full, hopefully 100% recovery. Tricky part is this, right? You say, oh, 9 to 12 months from week 2 is right around the beginning of the NFL season next year. However, because he tore these other things, the MCL and the meniscus, he let the MCL heal on its own. He also needed to give it time for the meniscus and the swelling around the ACL to go down in order to operate and have that surgery. So while he had the ACL tear in week 2, they did not operate on the ACL for another month. So you're looking at not a week 2 to next regular season timetable on that return. You're looking at more so in the week 6, 7, 8 range, because they had to let the swelling go down and these other parts that he tore heal. So when you hear that, like, a player tore all this other shit up, that's the reason it's concerning. It's not because, like, we're not worried about long-term an MCL or a meniscus tear. We're worried because now you have to give extra time before we can actually operate on the ACL, which means extra time on the back end of that rehab and that timetable for coming back at full strength. And the problem that I have with this is, you know, we've talked to Dr. Morse a lot, and he's worked with a lot of athletes in the professional sports range. He talks about how a lot of them don't get back to 100% mental health, right? Like, having full confidence in that leg after an ACL tear. It takes 2 years to get back to it. And I would argue that Saquon is probably the most, if not the most, one of the most instinctual runners in the NFL. In terms of, what I mean by that is, his, he relies purely on his instincts, and he relies purely on his legs to do a lot of the crazy things that you see him do, those one cut jumps and just the crazy agility that he has. He does that because he has 100% confidence in his legs that they'll do that without question. If he has even the slightest hesitation, he's not going to be the same Saquon Barkley that we've been used to. That being said, Saquon Barkley is just 24 years old. He is so young, and we give a little bit more leeway, a little bit more leverage to these younger players, because they can recover quickly. And if there's anybody in the NFL that can have an Adrian Peterson-like return from an ACL tear, it is this fucking cyborg that we know as Saquon Barkley. I will be monitoring this rehab about as closely as I can, about as closely as I have any rehab in fantasy football since I've been doing this YouTube shit. If all the rehab is positive, if we're seeing videos of him coming out and doing cuts and looking perfectly fine, he'll move all the way up my rankings, okay? But I tend to side on injury pessimism over optimism, because a lot of y'all are just so fucking optimistic about every injury, and more often than not, it comes back to bite you in the ass. But again, I will leave you with, don't ever forget, what you looking at, woman? Don't ever forget that Saquon Barkley went for over 2,000 yards from scrimmage and 15 touchdowns as a rookie. As a rookie. As a motherfucking rookie. That's what we got for y'all today. Next week's, we will cover 7 through 12. If you enjoyed the video today, make sure you hit that thumbs up button. Make sure you subscribe to the channel if you're new. And make sure you go check out Felix Gray, man. I'm telling you, as a friend, this is not me trying to pitch you. This is not me trying to get you to buy some shit. As a friend, I suggest these to all of my friends. You see Noah, those cheap-ass blue lights that he got from Amazon, those shit makes him look out of control. I'm going to get him a nice pair of Felix Gray. I suggest you get a pair of Felix Gray. If you got a loved one, if you got a husband or a wife or a son or whatever, and you see their eyes bleeding out their fucking face holes because all they do is stare at screens all day, Felix Gray, get the blue light. If you got prescription, they got them on there as well. If you're curious about the styles that I have, again, these are called the Hopper in black. These are more respectful. I can go into a library and pull any woman I want with these bad boys on. I love y'all. I'm out.